in this world. There are all sorts of things in this world that often give it to you, but they never quite keep their promise. If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. Hope is one of the theological virtues. This means that a continual looking forward to the eternal world is not a form of escapism or wishful thinking, but one of the things a Christian is meant to do. It does not mean that we are to leave the present world as it is. If you read history, you will find that the Christians who did most for the present world were just those who thought most of the next. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. Aim at heaven, and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth, and you will get neither. I must keep alive in myself the desire for my true country, which I shall not find till after death. I must never let it get snowed under or turned aside. I must make it the main object of life, to press on to that other country, and to help others to do the same. I included that today because today we're celebrating and remembering the life of St. Luke, the evangelist. And that is how it's listed in our calendar. St. Luke, the evangelist. We often know of him as the great physician, if you will, although Jesus is the greatest physician. But Luke was a doctor, a healer, and he wrote the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts. Although we're not sure if he ever actually met Jesus or if he was simply brought to belief in Christ after his death and resurrection, Jesus is dead. So as we remember the life of Luke, we find in him that he, as we saw in our epistle lesson, he worked with Paul in Paul's missionary journeys. And out of his relationship with Paul, he wrote the gospel that we now call St. Luke. And then he also penned and wrote the book of Acts, in which he describes what happens with the church after the death and resurrection of Christ. And we see in Luke an emphasis on people and the love of God for those people. There are more healing stories in the Gospel of Luke than in any of the other Gospel stories. So in today's lesson from Luke chapter 10, we have the account of Jesus sending out the 72, or as was in the reading in our prayer book, the 70. Jesus specifically chose those people to go out and prepare the way for his coming. Jesus had an itinerary in his mind. I'm going to go to these towns and cities and villages. I want you to go to those ahead of me and prepare them for my coming. And he gave them very specific instructions. But his first instruction was this: pray ye therefore. Pray that the Lord of the harvest would provide workers for the harvest. So their first job was prayer. Because Jesus knew that if it was just confined to the 12 or the 72, that the gospel wouldn't have much of a chance. But that the gospel message needed many to get the word. So, Jesus wanted, as C.S. Lewis so aptly said it, to help others do the same. Jesus was preparing the 12 and the 72 and other disciples who followed him to help people find hope, to help point the way towards heaven and how to get there. To know that life on this planet is not the end, but the beginning. And that is for us to take to the world as well. must make it the main object of life to press on to that other country and to help others do the same. So you and I are called to prepare ourselves for our next journey. When we go there. And we are also to help others prepare for that journey. In John chapter 1, verses 40 through 42, it says this. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, that is the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. Notice that when Andrew discovered Jesus and realized that he was the Messiah, the first thing he did was he went and told his brother, "Come and see. I found the Messiah." I can imagine Andrew's excitement at this discovery. They had been waiting, the Jewish people had been waiting for the Messiah. It wasn't exactly like what they pictured. They pictured it. David-like figure, a little bigger and stronger and whatnot. But Jesus was the Messiah. And Andrew realized, and he brought his brother Peter to meet him. So what we see in one of these first encounters of the apostles with Jesus is this excitement and enthusiasm and willingness to bring others. Right at the very beginning. And the first thing that Jesus told the 72 to do was to pray for more workers for the harvest. Jesus knew that there were people waiting for the Messiah, and that when they heard the message, that they would believe, but they needed to hear the message. And he knew he would only be able to visit so many towns and cities in Israel, and that there were other countries around the world that also needed to hear that message. Why? 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." God loves every person on this planet. He loves you, he loves me. He loves the people jogging by on the trail out there, all the people out on the golf course right now, all the people preparing to watch NFL football later. I'm getting ready in my mind. I'm ready. He loves all of us. Every person on the planet. He doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants all people to come. On the Sundays when we have the full Holy Communion service, the comfortable words include John 3:16. "For God so loved the world." That word "so" makes it even more powerful. "For God so loved the world." He loves you and me and everyone on this planet. He wants all of us to come to know his son Jesus so that our relationship with God can be restored and renewed and made right. That's what repentance does. That's what belief in Christ does. It restores our relationship with God. And so God is calling his people to take that message of heaven and of hope to everyone. That's the calling for all. I want to end with this quick little vignette and question from the headlines recently. On Thursday, October the 1st, Chris Harper Mercer Lord, we ask that you help each one of us as we live our life every day to always be aware of your presence and your power and your love for all the world around us. That we might remember